Cool, let's get started. Oseanworld, thanks a lot for joining us, and thanks for joining the Jenny DAO.
Yeah, of course. I'm excited to be here.
So maybe before we start, I'll just share the screen with everybody here just to show this masterpiece that you shared with the community. One second. Here we go. So you can see this on OpenSea. And you've created your whole virtual world, right? Like Oseanworld is, you know, people talk about the metaverse and this kind of virtual world where, you know, everything becomes digital and it's this whole parallel universe, right? That's online.
Yeah.
And you've already created this, right? You're ahead of your time.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah. I like world building a lot, like concepts, like conceptual worlds, and you know, like movies that like have like different universes and all that stuff or whatever. And that was really my passion since I was a kid, just like wanting to create like a world already and like in its own right and stuff. So it's cool to like finally be able to use all the tools that I like learned years and you know be able to actually like conceptualize and make my own kind of like you know like universe.
So maybe talk about what's going on here. This was a piece that you specifically tailor-made for the Jenny DAO, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so the whole concept is really just like the upside down world. In the stamp, the Jenny DAO stamp, there's like the plane that's like upside down. But like the whole entire idea is like with Oseanworld, I try and create like different universes that like fit certain narratives and stuff like that and certain concepts. And the plane being upside down, I was like, well, the plane wasn't necessarily upside down. You were just like looking at it from the wrong perspective or whatever. And technically you were the upside down one and the sky was like the ground. Like, the landscape was the sky and stuff. And like this whole entire, like me kind of like this whole thing, and I was like drawn and being like, okay, well, like how would the sky look if like you were standing on it and stuff like that, whether you'd be like standing on just the clouds or like would you be standing on the clouds and the actual color of the actual like sky field, like you know, just like coming up with that whole entire thing and like coming up with this entire piece. So I like created this like whole thing of like there's like me being able to like create this entire world where I like generate this like world generator and then like being able to shoot out this like entire universe throughout my hands and stuff like that, and coming up with the conceptualized world that I made and stuff like that, and realizing that like down at the sky and stuff like that, and then you like look up and there's like this whole entire like thing that you didn't even realize that was there in the first place, and then like all this stuff starts like at you and like there's your dragon there and all that kind of stuff or whatever. Where, yeah, it's literally just like this entire engulfed world of like things that I would want to happen if like, okay, cool. If I saw a plane in the sky, this is probably where it would be, you know? So, yeah.
So you work a lot with the idea of, you know, psychedelics, you know, without taking drugs, and you talk about distortion of reality and this whole idea of, you know, whether the airplane's upside down or whether we're upside down, I think really fits well with your, with the theme that comes over and over again in your work.
Yeah, I think like, drugs are like very important into like our society, whether it's like really, or like just weird things in general or whatever. And I haven't like done a whole bunch of drugs or whatever, and like, but like I'm very interested in the concept of it, of like these things that like basically like completely destroy your perspective of like what you already thought was like possible, and it like completely like renews it and like makes it a whole different structure. And like whether it's like seeing or thinking or like believing in something completely different from like what you already had is like very interesting to me. And I kind of like base all my work around, like, you think one thing is like one way, but it's really like something that's completely different. And then like, once you figure out that it's like completely different, it's almost taken away from you and stuff like that. And I think it's very interesting.
Very cool.
Appreciate it.
So maybe just talk about, you know, how your career started as an artist and how you got into the whole NFT space. I think you started in the music industry, right?
Yeah. So before I started doing like NFT stuff or whatever, I was always doing like music videos for like a bunch of kids and stuff. And it didn't really get serious until like I was like, I think like a sophomore in college. I did like a couple of videos for like Trippie Redd and stuff, and then like kind of blew up from there, where I was like doing commissions like every other week or whatever. And it was cool up until the point where I kind of wanted to do like my own thing, because it was almost like I was world building for pretty much everybody else except for myself. And I kind of got into art to, you know, world build for myself. I like stopped doing like a whole bunch of music videos, and like I just kind of like focused on myself for a while. And then I like met my friend Dico, and like we all like came up with the idea of like just collaborating together and stuff like that. And so now I do like his music videos all the time, but like in like retro, I like do my own stuff at the same time. So it's like this cool, like I get to like still do the kind of things that I like want to do, like already with the music videos, of being able to create other people's worlds, but also being able to fully into my own kind of thing, and like just be like completely separate and just like, you know, just get locked in my own world or whatever. So I think it's interesting. But I started out with like music videos, and then I got into like conceptual stuff super heavy, and then like I started doing like VFX work and stuff like that, and then like use that VFX work to like kind of just do my own personal stuff. So yeah.
Okay. And so you started with music videos, started to get into your own stuff, and then you started going completely off, right? And doing like Theatric City. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
Oh yeah, Daedric City. Yeah. So
tell us about that.
Yeah, so and so prior to like music videos, I was actually like a painter beforehand, and so like I've been doing like art since I was like a kid or whatever. I was like drawing like in sketchbooks, and like me and my friends, we would like draw like comic books and like composition notebooks and stuff like that in school. And we have like tens of hundreds of them, like, but we don't have them all because like the teachers would take them and stuff like that and like put them in their like drawers and stuff and be like, you can't draw anymore, kind of vibe or whatever. But we used to like draw all the time and stuff, and I used to like concept all these different worlds, and one of the worlds was like the Daedric City one. And it's like one of those like earlier concepts that I had came up with that I like brought back into like the forefront of like my life for a while. And when I had stopped doing music videos, I had like completely dove into this world or whatever, Daedric City, where it's literally just like mad chaos and like utter disarray and like not knowing where you are and like being completely lost in like your own mind and your own sauce and like not knowing where you want to go or like who you want to be and like basically just like running from your own brain because you don't understand what's going on to it and stuff. And
lots of flashes, lots of blurry episodes. It does get very confusing.
Yeah. And like it was weird too, because it's like one of those things where like I did it for completely just for myself, because like I didn't really have a whole bunch of people kind of like watching me at that time period. And it was like I was like wanting to do it to, you know, just like throw a whole bunch of ideas out there that I liked a lot, that was like completely like they're like concepts of concepts almost, to where they're just like so not deep, but just like convoluted in a way to where it's like almost confuses me, which is kind of funny. But yeah, it's just like one of those things where like I wanted to make like such these like in-depth like conceptual worlds that like and I just posted them on YouTube just to like be funny, and now it's like a whole thing which I like a lot, but it's like, oh dang, I didn't know people were gonna like it. So that's cool.
Yeah. So you've got your own vocabulary for the city. There's the Vega.
Yeah.
There's TV heads. There's Yamei, Kami. See, there's a little bit of a Japanese anime influence in there too.
Yeah. It's funny too, because like all of my friends, like me and all of my friends, we all like watch anime and, you know, just like hang out and like do fun stuff or whatever. But like for the most part, it's like, yeah, like the cartoons and like the anime and like all that kind of stuff was like big influential, because when I first dove into like 3D stuff, like the main look of like 3D was almost like that like people crap ass style, which obviously amazing or whatever, but it was like one of those things where like I wanted to figure out a way to almost make like cartoons in 3D, and like I've seen it happen before, but it was almost like impossible when I first started doing it. But like that like intrigued me more to do it or whatever, is that like trying to figure out how to like make 3D look almost like you're watching cartoons, but it still looks completely 3D. And like, so like the bounciness of things, or like the weird frame rates, or like the like super saturated colors, like very like off kilter things that like you wouldn't necessarily see in a straight like perfect 3D render and stuff like that. It like really intrigues me and stuff. So yeah. And characters and stuff, like the personification of like characters also like really intrigues me too, is that like most 3D stuff that I've usually seen, it like has like this like super simple like character, and then like it'll have like cool drapery or like some kind of thing or like really cool textures, but like I haven't seen a lot of characters where they're like you really want to relate to them just because they look so unique and like weird and like they're just like strange characters, unless in movies or something. Like, I think that like personification of characters don't really, they don't get like enough attention and stuff like that in movies as much as they should in like real life and stuff like that. It's really cool.
Mm-hmm. Totally. So tell us about what the Hyperrealm is.
So the Hyperrealm, it's like this next part of like the Daedric City vibe or whatever. So I do like these like stages and like arcs and stuff. So Daedric City was about like being convoluted and like very like lost and all that kind of stuff or whatever. And the Hyperrealm is basically almost like the opposite. It's like hyper clarity to the point where it's become simple and like it's like truly about like just power and like ferocity and like foreignness and like being fast and like being like to the point and like just like understanding everything, like just seeing everything and like going for it and kind of stuff like that. And like all the cities and like all the things and like all the like stuff in this world is like you see it, it's here, like everything's like to the point, like it's very like, yeah, it's like this concept of this world of like being like hyper understanding basically. It's yeah,
it's just like we reach the next stage of enlightenment in
life. Yeah.
We go for start at Oseanworld and then go through some kind of meditation process to reach the next level.
Yeah, and it's funny too, because like so I have a lot of friends that are like really into like spirituality and stuff like that, and like I like spirituality for like concepts and like ideas and stuff, and a lot of them are they're basically like these things where like you go through these like specific journeys just to like find certain things. So like you start at the bottom of this hill, like this hill or whatever, and you go all the way to the top and you find like this crazy thing or whatever, and then you like can either stay at the top of this hill or you can like go to another hill or you can like go to a higher hill or like whatever. And like the whole point of it is that like you'll never like stop going to like all these different hills and stuff like that. And like with the Daedric City one, it was like this gigantic hill that like I like completely climbed and stuff like that. And having to go to like this Hyperrealm hill is like a completely different thing, but it almost is like once you go down this like gigantic like rabbit hole of like going to a different hill, it gives you more backstory and like more depth and more clarity of like what you want to do and like how you want to go about things and stuff.
Nice. So, you know, the reason I really love, you know, I guess everybody relates with your art differently, right? Mm-hmm. The reason that I'm really attracted to it is that we're all talking about building the metaverse, and I think a lot of artists have come up with NFTs, and NFTs you don't have to place them in the metaverse. I think just owning cool JPEG in itself, I think is already pretty cool.
Right.
But it becomes really cool once you start embedding yourself in this virtual world, and the virtual world will be powered by blockchain.
Right.
And I think projects like Sandbox, which are trying to replicate this whole virtual world, are really doing amazing work. And we're all talking about building this, but you've already built your virtual world as an artist.
Yeah.
And I think making, you know, right now we've just got videos which are NFTs. But I think what would be really cool is to actually have NFTs embedded within the Oseanworld metaverse.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really where you can start taking your art to the next level. And that'll be, you know, that's going to be $1 billion project, I think, once that starts happening.
No, yeah. And it's funny, too. Like, well, it's one of those things where, like, I've always wanted to be, like, that person that, like, makes this, like, really cool game or, like, super interactive thing or whatever. And like every single time I've gotten into it, it's gotten because with videos and stuff, like with pictures, right? It was like this thing to where it's like, okay, this picture has to be like the most perfect thing in the world. And you like spend like 6 days on this picture and you're like, oh, amazing, right? And then you get to like videos and you're like, okay, now it's like gone from like a day to now like almost like 4 months. And you're like, oh, okay, cool. Now the video is like amazing. And then like when you get into video games, it's like, now you're spending like 9 years on these videos. And you're like, it's like such a stretch of a project. And it's like the thing, and it's like, it doesn't scare me that it's 9 years or like that it's like not going to be worth it or anything like that. It's just one of those things where like, I want to have the most perfect, like not even perfect, just the most coolest like idea of concept of the world to the point where like I can be like, yeah, I made that. That's cool. Like the point to where like, people that are in it truly enjoy it because it's not like some super hype train thing or like some like weird thing, but it's like really like a literal world that you truly enjoy to be in and stuff like that. I think that's like really interesting, because like with the sandboxes and like the crypto voxels and stuff like that, like putting up for display and stuff like that, like I've been in there and they look really amazing and stuff like that, and like the fact that they're like the first ones of their kind is like the part that like makes me intrigued and stuff, is that like I can really walk that there. And like the thing that I've found out is that like what makes it perfect is that like the people are building it instead of like the creator building it. And I think that's like one of the things that I've like taken away from like a lot of this stuff, is that like creating like that perfect video game or like that thing that was gonna like take 9 years has like completely switched over to now, like what kind of construct can I build to where like the people that are involved in it can like make their own perfect reality and stuff like that. So that's where my head's at pretty much.
So that's one thing, is that Oseanworld is right now you. Mm-hmm. You know, there's an avatar who looks a lot like you. I don't know if it's self-portrait.
Yeah.
I guess he kind of dresses like you. He's young. Like it feels a little bit like self-portrait, right?
Yeah.
And you've kind of built your own world. But to really make it into a metaverse, you need a social aspect, and you need other people to be able to interact with it. Right. And ideally other people to be able to come in and build on it. Mm-hmm. So I should be able to come and add on my own section of Oseanworld, right? Where I've got my own dragons and my own upside down clouds and whatever. But as a perfectionist, you're probably not going to want that, right? You're probably going to want to have some kind of control.
I actually do want those things. So like this app called VR Chat, and I like bring this up every single time someone like has like just talked to me, period, because I think it's like the perfect like idea of like the things that I would necessarily want, that like it's almost like the real world, and it's real world's kind of messed up right now, but like the like if we're like talking about just like the perfect constructs and stuff like that, is that like the universe itself like already is like built in a way where it's like super amazing, is that like you have like all these multiple universes, like you have all these like different planets and stars and like all these other things or whatever that we can technically go to, we just haven't gotten advanced enough to get there or whatever, but there's all these different worlds to explore, all these like whatchamacallits to build. But the more important part is that like humans are able to do exactly whatever they want to do, like we've gotten to the point where we can now build our own worlds inside of like the world that we live in or whatever. That's how like how creative this world already is or whatever. And so like me wanting to build a world or whatever, I almost want it to be like that, to where like you can literally do anything you want to inside of this like whole entire like metaverse, if I made it or whatever. If like I would make it look like the stuff that I like or whatever, but like the core of the actual places that I want it to be, that like you're able to do what you want to do, not what I want you to do. It's like I'll give you things to do inside of there if you're not like a person like me where you want to create things or whatever, and like I'll give you things to where like you're not bored, or like you get to find things, or you can be lost or whatever. But like the main core of it is that like I want people that want to be able to create, to be able to create whatever they want. So yeah,
I think it's a super exciting concept. And, yeah, we look forward to working with you more on this kind of stuff.
Yeah, no.
And, no, once again, thank you so much for sharing your work with the Jenny DAO. I think we're a community that loves collecting cool stuff, and you're at the top of the list.
I appreciate it. No, I'm glad to be here. It's awesome.
So we'll take some questions from the audience. There's one question here. Are you planning to sell your character as a NFT?
I'm doing this. I can't say.
Uh-oh. Any hints?
Thing going on to where like I'll be able to sell characters. Yep, there we go. That's all I'm gonna say.
So there's gonna be more than one character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's like so I've created like a bunch of characters, like those like main what five or six that I've like posted on YouTube or whatever, there's like 60 more of those. I just haven't put them on the internet because I'm not ready, so but
okay. Yeah, that's your perfectionist side.
it's not even perfection. It's just like one of those things where like, so like Tommy has a story, L has a story, Choice has a story, Yami has a story, Doomdoo has a story. Like, I'm working on like all five of their stories at the same time or whatever. And so it's like, if I like tried to add another one, it would just be like, all right, now I'm working on their story or whatever. Or like, some of them don't have stories, but like to put them in the mix right now wouldn't make any sense or whatever. So I'm just like, I'll wait for it. I'll let it stay there, you know, like it's going to be in the bank for a while. And then when the perfect time comes out, it's like, boom, new character. So yeah, I have a lot of characters and stuff. Yeah.
Cool. I'll make sure to give Jenny DAO a heads up when you do.
Yeah, for sure.
So I've got another question here. You come from a music background. Your videos themselves don't have your music. Are you going to collaborate with artists or anything for your NFTs in the future?
Yeah, of course. Right now, like when I first started, I like to play violin when I was a kid and stuff like that. And like over the years, I like learned how to use loops and stuff. My friend Dika like taught me how to use Fruity Loops, and I was like already using Ableton beforehand. But yeah, a lot of people always hit me up about like beats and all that kind of stuff or whatever. And for season two, I definitely want to put like a lot of people that was like asking me for collaborations and stuff into season two. So I think it'd be really cool just to collaborate with people on NFTs too.
Cool. I've got a LinkedIn user who's sending questions saying, OMG, I love the t-shirt. Thank you very much. This is not even a real McDonald's t-shirt. It comes from Taobao. But you know, we always say that we've always got second plan in case this crypto stuff doesn't work out.
Yeah.
And in my case, I realized that I had an intern working over the summer doing some dev work. And the year before that, he was in high school and he was he did a summer job at McDonald's. And to get the job at McDonald's, just for summer job, he had to do two interviews. One of them was in English. Second one was in Mandarin. And that made me realize that I'm not even qualified enough to work at McDonald's. So in my case, like this crypto thing really needs to work out because there's no plan B.
Yeah, no, in fact. I mean, like, it's cool though, because that was the first thing I literally said when I like pulled up on the chat. I was like, oh, this shirt is dope. Like, I mean, like, crypto thing doesn't work. So that cool shirt, like, it's really tight. So.
All right, guys. So that's it. We'll call it a day. Oseanworld, thanks so much for everything.
Yeah, for sure. I'm glad.
And keep in touch with DAO.
Yeah, for sure. I appreciate it.
Bye-bye. Peace out.